Good morning and welcome to Calendar Bay Church Online. I'm Pastor John Intoff, and thank you so much for joining us for our online service today. I want to give you a heads up because I don't think we let you know the week before that we're going to be celebrating communion during the service today. So if you do need to take a moment in order to be able to get ready, maybe grab some juice and some bread, you can do that right now. I'm going to just be doing some announcements, and if you need to listen to them, you can rewind it. I don't know. We'll figure it out. But I just wanted you to be prepared as we go to communion today. Well, there is a couple different ways that you can enjoy the online service. One, you can do the YouTube premiere, which takes place every Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. You can watch the service with other people, but you can also watch the service at any point after that. And so you can, just whenever it's convenient for you, watch the service and enjoy the online service in those couple different ways. Also, right now, we have our in-person service going here at Calendar Bay Church. No restrictions, so we can have as many people, well, restrictions in the sense that you can't overload the building because of fire code and those type of things, but there's no restrictions because of COVID. You don't have to wear a mask. You can wear one if you so wish. And so that is 10:30 Sunday morning here at Calendar Bay Church. And so whether you enjoy the online service or in person, we appreciate your connection here with Calendar Bay Church. Mark your calendars. High Power Soccer is coming up on August 15 to 19. It'll be from 9 a.m. to noon. We're looking for workers. Registration, I think, is live on our webpage. And so if you're interested in registering, just go to our webpage and you can register your child there. And so more information is on our webpage as well. And so we hope that our High Power Soccer, I heard registration took off like a shot. There's a lot of people registered right at the beginning. So please do that. And it's going to be a great time. August 15 to 19 at the Calendar Community Center. Oh, next weekend is Father's Day, and we're going to be having a Father's Day barbecue here at the church. And so if you're interested in that, just come on out to the service. We'll have some food afterwards. I think they want you to bring a dessert as well. There's more information on our Facebook page, or you can go to our webpage as well. Just a couple ministry opportunities that are available. Number one, we're looking for a secretary slash administrator here at Calendar Bay Church. And so if you're interested in that, this is a paid position, about 16 hours a week. And so if you're interested, there's more info on the bulletin board. It's also online at our webpage. And so if that's something that might be of interest to you, please take a look. And if you're really interested, you can apply for that position. We're also hoping to, when we get back into September, be able to reboot our nursery and beginner junior church. And so if that's something that might be of interest to you, please speak to me, and I'd love to get you some more information about that. I'm encouraging people to stay connected, and we have a Facebook group that you can join. We also have an email that we send out 5 days a week, just giving you some words of encouragement that you can use on your spiritual journey. It also keeps you updated to the things happening here at Calendar Bay Church. And so I would encourage you to stay connected in that way. Thank you for your ongoing support of Calendar Bay Church. And if you would like to give to Calendar Bay Church, there's a couple ways that you can do that. Number one is by going online to our webpage, and you can safely and securely give by going to calendarbaychurch.ca/give, and you can safely and securely give there. The other way is by mail, and you can mail your gift to our mailing address, which is Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. That's Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. Well, as we prepare for communion, we want to sing about Jesus' work on the cross. And this song is called Man of Sorrows. And we want to use it to get our hearts prepared that we have a man of sorrows who is acquainted with our grief. And so let's sing this together and worship him this morning.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of men and wrath of took a crown of thorns. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase sin, redeem, and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah. And honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. The sun sets free.
As we celebrate around the communion table, we remind ourselves that Jesus did this at the Last Supper as a way of bringing to the forefront what was to be of most importance. You know, it's kind of like if you were to go on a journey and you had older kids and you left them a list of the things that you needed to do. It's kind of like that Jesus wanted to make sure that what was of most importance got moved to the forefront. And Jesus wanted us to remember his sacrifice on the cross, the love that was showed to each one of us, and also the ongoing impact of Jesus's sacrifice on the cross. And as we partake together, we want to do so and remember what Christ has done with a heart that is full of gratefulness. I always think communion is an amazing time in order to be able to take a moment and just to be able to give thanks to God. because his gift to each one of us and the sacrifice that he made is just so overwhelming that it makes us well up with gratefulness. And so I want you to take a moment right now. You know, if you're watching the video with somebody, watching this service with somebody else, I want you to take a moment right now and tell the person that's with you something that you are grateful for. The Word of God tells us to give thanks in all circumstances, and by doing so, we fulfill the will of God. And so I want you to just express to those that are around you as you watch what you are grateful for. Or if you're by yourself, just express it out loud to God. God, I am so thankful for, and then you fill in the blank. Because God wants us to be grateful. And that he wants us to have a heart that is full of thanksgiving for all that we have been given and all that has been done for us. And as you say those things, let's just lift those up as a sacrifice of praise to God. Jesus, we thank you for all the good things that you bring into our lives. And we pray, Father, that you would accept these gifts of thanks unto you. We want to say thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. We want to thank you for the love that brought you to that point. And we want to thank you for the overwhelming generosity that you continue to show in our lives. You continue to show your goodness, your faithfulness, and your love in every circumstance. And so, Father, we thank you and we give you thanks. And as we take the symbol of your broken body in our hands and we eat it, we say, thank you, Jesus. We remember your sacrifice and we will tell others of that great sacrifice. And as we eat together, it's with a heart that is full of gratefulness for your work on the cross. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's eat it together. Jesus also on the night that he was betrayed, he took the cup and he said, this cup represents the new covenant that is in my blood and you are to drink it in remembrance until he comes. And so Jesus leaves us here on the earth with the purpose of bringing his message to others. And as we hold in our hands the symbol of his shed blood that was given not just for you, but for all, I want you to be thinking of those that you could be bringing the message of Jesus to. And I want you to be thinking of those people because we're going to pray for them in just a second. And we want to say, thank you, Jesus, that you were willing to sacrifice your blood so that I could be in a right relationship with you. And you've left us me here to be your ambassador to bring the message to others. And so let's just take a moment and let's lift up those individuals that you're thinking of. God, we lift up these individuals that need to have a relationship with you. And we say, thank you, Jesus, that your blood is powerful and it reaches down to wherever we are at. And we pray, Father, for these individuals that need to have a relationship with you. And as we drink together in remembrance of your sacrifice, we say, thank you, Jesus, that your shed blood reaches down to each of us. And it continues that wonder-working power into the lives of others. And we claim that promise and we claim these lives in Jesus' name that they would come to know you. And so, Father, we thank you for this shed blood. And we pray, Father, that you would use it to reach the world. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's drink together. We want to praise the name of Jesus for his work on the cross. And that Jesus calls us to remember. And let's sing this song as a song of remembrance. Remembering what Christ did so that we can give thanks to him. Let's sing it together.
I see his wounds. His feet, my Savior on that cursed tree.
We're continuing on a series of messages called If You Want to Walk on Water, You Got to Get Out of the Boat. And today's topic, I think, is of real importance as we talk about the idea of being resilient. I think that we all need to learn to be resilient in our faith. And there's lots of different things that challenge that resilience in our lives. And I particularly found this week to be a difficult week and lots of things that seem to challenge that idea. And it reminded me of a story from my own life of when I went to Jasper in the summer of 1985. This is a picture of me, a very skinnier me, on the Opal Hills just outside of Jasper, hiking. I think that was in June and there was still snow. I actually fell through the snow, but that's a story for another day. But I was reminded of my journey to get to Jasper. What had happened was is that I got connected with a coffee house that happened at a Baptist church in Jasper called the Bedford Inn. And so basically what you did is you went to Jasper for the summer, you got a job, but you also helped out at this coffee house on the weekends just to be able to, we would talk and sit at tables, have tea, coffee, and then we would also have some performers who sang songs. And it was just a great way of being able to minister to people in Jasper at that time frame. Now, so I had arranged all the details to get there. And so what I did was is I bought a ticket with my income tax return so that I would be able to fly out to Edmonton. And then I had arranged so that I would meet up with the guy in Jasper. And then so what happened was is that best laid plans of mice and men. So what happened was is that I flew into Edmonton. Now, you probably, if you've been to Edmonton Airport before, know this. I didn't know this at this point. When I flew into Edmonton, I didn't know how far the Edmonton Airport was from Edmonton. And so I thought I would just arrive at Edmonton. I would take a bus or a cab or something like that to get to the bus station where I needed to catch my bus so that I could get to Jasper. So I arrived in Edmonton, I think around 10 p.m. at night. And all of a sudden I am stranded and I'm not sure how I'm going to get to Edmonton because I hadn't arranged for somebody to pick me up at the airport. And so there I am in Edmonton Airport. And good news is that I actually bumped into somebody from my college that I was going to, and I knew them, and they said, oh, no, we can bring you in. And so it was like, whoop, that's good. And so I got a ride into Edmonton, and they said, well, where are you going? I said, well, I just wanted to go to the bus station, and it's 11 o'clock at night, but my bus leaves at 7 in the morning, and so I'll just hang out at the bus station until that point, and then I'll just catch my bus in the morning. So I went into the Edmonton bus station, they dropped me, I said, see you later, and they drove away. So I'm sitting in the Edmonton bus terminal, and there was something that I noticed quite early is that I was the only one in the Edmonton bus station at that time. And I thought, oh, this is a little bit strange. And so I sat there for a few minutes with my luggage. And then a janitor came out of the bathroom and he says, what are you doing here? And I said, well, I'm waiting for my bus. And he said, how did you get in? I said, well, I went in through the door. Well, I found out that I really wasn't the terminal was supposed to be closed. I was just lucky that I found a door that was open, and there I am standing in the Edmonton bus terminal, and I'm being kicked out onto the street. So I am walking down Jasper Avenue at around 11:30, 12 o'clock at night with my luggage, and basically with a sign on my forehead saying, mug me please, I want to be mugged, I'm from Ontario, I don't know where I'm going. And so I went to a hotel. I found a hotel that I'm embarrassed to say this, that this hotel had hourly rates. So you can tell what level of hotel this was. Anyway, so I ended up crashing at this place and leaving as early as I could in the morning. And eventually I caught the bus to Jasper. Everything seemed to be back on track until I reached in Jasper and found out that I had miscommunicated what time the bus was going to be arriving. And so the person that was supposed to be picking me up at the bus station wasn't there. And so there I am now walking down the streets of Jasper trying to find the Baptist church in order to be able to figure out where I'm going from there. And the lesson that I'm going to try to tell you about this story is that sometimes in life, things don't go as planned. Things don't work out. Plans go awry. Things just do not go as they planned. And I learned that firsthand as I was trying to get where I thought God wanted me to go. But on the journey to get to that point, every single thing that I had thought I had arranged in advance didn't work out. And it was probably stupidity on some part, but things just didn't go as planned. Bringing us back to our story, where Peter is getting out of the boat and he is about to walk on the water, and then things don't go quite as what they were planned. This is what it says in Matthew 14, verses 29 and 30. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink and cried out, "Lord, save me." Here we have in the passage of Scripture, Peter is accomplishing what no other not divine human being like Jesus has done, walk on water. But then there's this phrase that happens in this Scripture, which is one that I think so aptly describes what happens when we step out in faith and things don't go very well. The phrase is that Peter saw the wind. Peter looked at his circumstances that were around him and was overwhelmed by them. Peter saw the wind. And oftentimes when we are going through difficult circumstances, there seems to be two responses that we have to seeing the wind. Number one is that one group of people is defeated by that. You know, in Peter's circumstances, he was overwhelmed, he became afraid, he was anxious, and then he sank. And then there's another group of people that are marked by resilience in the midst of difficulty. And I think God wants us to learn to be resilient in the midst of the difficulties. Because if we're really interested in doing what God wants us to do, there are going to be those moments when, you know what, we are going to see the wind. That we are going to see the difficulties and the bad things all around us. And in those moments, we have an opportunity to make a choice. We can choose to be defeated by those circumstances, or we can choose by God's strength to be resilient. Resiliency is a condition whereby people actually enlarge their capacity to handle problems and in the end not only survive, but grow in the midst of that. And God wants us to grow in resilience. God does not want us, as the writer of in Scripture says, tossed to and fro by every wave and wind. God doesn't want us to be tossed around. He wants us to learn to be resilient in the midst of it. Resilient people, there's some things about resilient people. Number one is that they do not merely see themselves as passive victims. A lot of times in North American society, we take on the idea that we're victims, that everything makes us into a victim. And when you become a victim, you think that everything else is everyone else's fault. It's not your fault. If I would have had better circumstances or better things that happened to me, I would have been better. I would have been more resilient. But resilient people don't merely see themselves as victims. And in the midst of that, they begin to develop and grow in moral courage. That God wants us to grow in moral courage, to be able to stand up for those things that are right. And he wants us to have moral courage. And he wants us to be able to find meaning and purpose in the midst of the difficulty. Many of us become defeated by our circumstances, but God wants us not to be defeated, but to learn to thrive and find meaning and purpose in the midst of those difficulties. Because God is always working in our lives. You know, what is it, the song that says, "Even when I don't see it, I know you're working." And sometimes in the midst of our circumstances, when things don't go quite right, it is hard for us to see that God is still working. But resilient people can see that in the midst of it, that God is still working. There's a great good news, bad news story that is found in the Bible. I remember as a kid, we would often do that where we would talk about what's the good news, what's the bad news? And you would do this kind of, well, the good news is this, but the bad news is this. Well, then the good news is this, but the bad news is this. Well, there's a story in Scripture where it goes through a number of scenarios where his life is good, other times it's bad, then it's good, and it's back and forth. And it's the story of Joseph, and it's found in Genesis 37:50. And so it's quite an extensive piece of Scripture. So we just kind of want to take a bird's eye view of this story, because we see that Joseph, in the midst of this, learns how to be resilient. And I think there's lots that we can learn from him. And so in the story of Joseph, we find this kind of good news story, good news, bad news. And so here we have Joseph, who is the favorite son of his father, Jacob. And so Jacob loves Joseph. And so that's some good news. That's really good. Now, the problem is because he was his dad's favorite, all his siblings really don't like him at all. Now, Joseph created some of this scenario by telling him dreams of how he was going to be better than them. And so they really didn't like Joseph at all. And that's really some bad news. Now, because Joseph was his father's favorite, Joseph's dad got him a beautiful multicolored coat. And so that's good. His dad loves him and gives him this very extravagant gift. The bad news is that because of that coat, his brothers hated him even more. And so they rip the coat off of him. They cover it in blood. They throw Joseph into a pit. They sell him into slavery. They bring the coat to his dad and say, well, you must have been killed by wild animals. Here's blood all over his coat. Joseph is dead. And so Joseph is now sold into slavery. And so this is all very much bad news. Now, as Joseph is sold into slavery, he ends up in Egypt. And in Egypt, he ends up being hired in a household of a guy by the name of Potiphar. Now, Potiphar was a person of quite a bit of wealth and responsibility. And as Joseph worked in his house, he began to work his way up and eventually got himself to be the manager of Potiphar's complete household. And so that is some good news. Well, the bad news is that Potiphar's wife takes a lot of interest in Joseph, if you know what I mean. And so he constantly being barraged by Potiphar's wife, who wants to sleep with him. And Joseph, good news, resists because he doesn't want to wreck the relationship in his working environment. And so he resists that temptation. The bad news is, it seems that, this is an interesting side note, that in the story of Joseph, it's his cloaks that get him into trouble. So, originally, it was this multicolored coat that his brothers hated and his dad loved and gave it to him that eventually causes difficulty. Now, in this situation, Potiphar's wife goes after Joseph, and eventually Joseph all he can do in order to be able to avoid the situation is run away. And so in that moment, Potiphar's wife grabs his cloak, and now his cloak is used as evidence to say that he was trying to go after Potiphar's wife, and so she actually used it to get him into trouble. So bad news is that Joseph is thrown into prison. And while he's in prison, he interprets some dreams of his room, the guys that are in jail with him, and it works out for one of the guys. And so Joseph says, hey, remember me when you get out there, because I'm trapped in prison here. You know, if you could put in a good word for me, you know, maybe this would turn around. But the guy forgets. And so the bad news is that Joseph rots in jail a little bit longer. But eventually he ends up getting out of jail and rises to prominence to be one of the top individuals in all of Egypt because of being able to interpret one of Pharaoh's dreams. And so the good news, and eventually he uses that authority to be able to build his relationships with his siblings, which have been broken. And so here we have this incredible story, the up and down. Joseph's life is not a straight line in order to get to that point where it's an incredible, great story. It's up and down. Life happens to Joseph. And as we look at Joseph's life, there are three decisions that we see in his life that are the decisions that we need to make if we want to be resilient people. Because resilient people live confidently under the sovereignty of God. The resilient person knows that bad things are going to happen. But even though they are under those bad things, they are even more under the sovereignty of God, that God is still in control and God is working out his purposes and his plans. But bad things are still going to happen even in spite of that. And the resilient person chooses faith over circumstance. His life looks like it is completely out of control. Joseph's life has gone from, you know, being the favored son to being a slave to working his way up. And eventually, it's this roller coaster life that he's a part of. And from the outsider's perspective, his life looks completely out of control. And many of us decide we give up when there's adversity. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if Joseph would have been tempted to say, God, I don't even know if you're there, because my life is an absolute, utter, spinning out of control mess. It's a disaster. And probably he would have been tempted to just say, you know what? The heck with this. But resilient people know that God is greater than their circumstances. That even in the midst of their circumstances, they know that God is still working in the background. And faith believes we are not helpless victims. And as we move through the story, there's an interesting scripture in Genesis 39:2, and it says, "The Lord was with Joseph, even in the midst of all the craziness and the bad things." Joseph knew that God was with him. And growth happens when we wholly and faithfully trust in God in a situation when we do not like or fully understand whether we see the wind. God wants us to learn to be resilient under the sovereignty of God, knowing that although our life circumstances can be spinning out of control, God has still got his hand on it, and he is leading, and he's not allowing anything that is not a part of his purpose or his plan. And resilient people choose to not compromise in the midst of this. And in this way, resilient people choose faith over comfort. And then this part of the story, we move to when Joseph has to wrestle with temptation. And in this circumstance, we find out that Potiphar, you know, most of the time when we look at this story, we assume that Potiphar's wife must have been quite attractive. There isn't any point that tells us that she wasn't, but we don't know that for sure. But whatever it is, Potiphar's wife certainly has her eyes on Joseph. And probably at this point, Joseph could have rationalized to choose some personal pleasures over his principles. I think a lot of us could do that. We can justify, well, you know, I've had a hard day, I've had a hard week. It's been hard right now. I can justify sacrificing my principles because, well, it's for my own pleasure. But even in the midst of this, what does Joseph do? He stands firm. Joseph stands firm even in the midst of this. And so he doesn't choose to, for the temporary over the eternal. You know, there's a story of Joseph's father, of Jacob and Esau, where Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of soup. And sometimes we do that. We give up what is important for a temporary moment. And Joseph in this story ends up running away from it, and it costs him because he got shafted and he got thrown into jail. But even in the midst of that, Joseph chooses to do the right thing. Probably in Northern Ontario, we've seen a bug zapper, you know, the ones that, bugs go and they die as they hit it. You know, I've seen some bug zappers that underneath it is a gigantic pile of dead bugs. You would think, though, that one of these bugs would have said, "Hey, guys, don't go to the light. Don't do it. It's dangerous." But they don't. They just continue to go to the light, and then they fall down dead. Oftentimes, there are temptations that are out there, those things that are temporary pleasures. And I think that a lot of us are like the bugs going to the light. We're drawn to it, and we've heard that it might be a bad decision, but we keep going anyway, and we're done. Problems and discouragement are the blue light that makes sin irresistible. You know, we go through difficulties and we go through hardships. And so what do we decide to do? We decide to go to the blue light, hoping that that somehow is going to offer something better. And then, pfft. North American society is full of temptations and pleasures that draw us away from being resilient in our faith. And many people who, the scripture talks about, those individuals who shipwreck their lives. There are lots of people that, because of adversity and difficulty, instead of choosing to be resilient, they have shipwrecked their lives, or using the bug zapper, burnt up their lives. Resilient people learn to not compromise in the midst of difficulties, that they learn to stand firm. And resilient people, the last point here, resilient people find meaning and purpose in the storm. And so they choose faith over failure. Viktor Frankl was a psychiatrist who was in World War II concentration camps, and he discovered that those who had no goals or purposes in the concentration camp didn't survive. But those that helped others, that found meaning and purpose in the midst of the adversity, those were the ones who lived to tell the tale. But those that were selfish and just kept to themselves and didn't find any meaning in the difficulty that they were going, they quickly died. Another interesting note is that they did a study of suicide notes and discovered that the key theme was that they were devoid of hope and that life was meaningless or without purpose. And so there was a lot of places they didn't talk about their jobs or their finances or some of the other precipitating factors that may have eventually, it was the point that there was no meaning or purpose in the midst of it, that was the final straw, that they were living devoid of hope. And resilient people learn to find purpose in the storm. And here we find Joseph. He has been wrongfully put in prison. He was trying to run. He was actually being a good employee in this situation. He was being true to his master and avoiding Potiphar's wife. And so here we have him wrongfully thrown in prison. And so, you know, if you were wrongfully thrown in prison, you would probably want to complain and grump about everything. But here we have Joseph in jail, and he learns to find meaning and purpose in the midst of the storm. Because if you go back to the beginning of the story of Joseph, he had been pretty arrogant about his dreams of greatness. And he had told his brothers about how great he was going to be and that they were going to bow down to him. And so he had been arrogant in that, and it just annoyed his brothers to no end. And so what does God do? God puts Joseph in difficult and hard things so that he could learn to develop compassion. In the midst of this difficult circumstances, he actually finds two other individuals that are in the prison with him. And he says, I see that your faces are down. What's wrong? And so here in the midst of his own difficult circumstances, what is Joseph doing? He is interested and concerned about others. And so as Joseph has gone on his journey, all of a sudden we see that he is developing compassion for other people. And he's also learns to serve in the midst of it. So we see him serving other people. And even the jailer is impressed with how he works within the jail. He has learned to serve and he has learned compassion in the midst of the difficulty. Now, it seems that Joseph has learned to find meaning and purpose in the midst of his difficulty. Because storms have a way of teaching us what nothing else could. And God sometimes puts us in difficult circumstances because maybe we've got some rough edges that need to be sanded. Or maybe there is something else that we can that we have to learn. You know, God sometimes puts us in positions so that we can be more understanding and less judgmental. That God puts us in circumstances because difficulty and hardships are teachers like no other. And Joseph's story, roller coaster all around, teaches him to be more resilient, to be more compassionate, and to teach him how to serve. And Joseph begins at the end of his life, is able to reflect, and he says, as at the end of the story, he said that, you know what, my brothers, when you put me in jail and or sold me into slavery, that you intended to harm me, but God used it to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. In the midst of all of this, from an outsider's perspective, it looked like everybody was trying to do harm to Joseph. But in the midst of it, what does he learn? He learns that even though it looked from an outsider's perspective like it was going bad, God was working it out and intending it for good. God works everything out for good for those who are loved and called according to his purposes. And so resilient people learn to find meaning in the midst of the difficulty. The question we have to ask ourselves is this, is are we seeing the wind? Are we like Peter who, you know, we stepped out in faith to live our lives for God, and then circumstances and difficulties began to overwhelm us and we saw the wind and we began to crash? And if we are seeing the wind, God wants us to call us to be resilient individuals who learn to find the meaning and the purpose in the midst of the difficulty, to learn to not compromise in the midst of it, and to learn compassion and servanthood in the midst of it. You know, one of my favorite Christmas movies is the movie It's a Wonderful Life. And in the story of It's a Wonderful Life, it's actually an interesting story because the movie It's a Wonderful Life was actually a box office failure, even though now it's considered to be one of the greatest movies of all time. And even in its time, it was nominated for Academy Award for Best Picture. It didn't win, but it was nominated. But it didn't make its budget. And some strange circumstances happened to the movie It's a Wonderful Life. What happened was is that its copyright didn't get renewed. And so what happened is that it became what is basically called public domain because they didn't renew the copyright on it. And so in the 1970s, TV was beginning to show movies a lot more on TV. And so what happened was is that this movie at Christmas time got shown a lot because it was cheap. They could show it on a network and there wasn't any copyright or royalties that needed to be paid. And so all of a sudden, It's a Wonderful Life was discovered by another generation and now became the Christmas classic that it is today because of a mistake. But the other side of it is that it began... It resonated with baby boomers because the key character, which is Jimmy Stewart's character, is stuck in a life that he didn't want. He wanted to travel the world. He wanted to do great things. And yet he ends up stuck in his hometown and eventually gets to the point where he is desperate and he's discouraged and was going to take his own life. And this is where baby boomers resonate with the fact, is my life making a difference? Is there a greater plan? Is there something going on? And an angel shows Jimmy Stewart that his life has meaning and it has purpose. And God wants us to know that even though our lives are not going the way that we think it maybe should, and that it's not the way that we had intended, God is still working things out for good. And what other people meant to do that you thought was to bring harm in your life, God is using it for good. And so the important message that we need to take from this is this. God wants us to learn resilience. You know what? Life is going to be hard. Life is going to be difficult. And we are going to see the wind. But even though we see the wind, that doesn't mean that God is not trying to accomplish his purposes. And God wants us to learn to be resilient in him. Because difficulties will come, but God is greater. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you call us to be resilient individuals, to find meaning in the mess, to choose fear or faith over failure, to choose faith over our circumstances, to choose faith in you over all things. And so we pray, Father, that you would help us to be able to be resilient individuals who are able to take a stand for you in this difficult society where we see the wind all around us. Help us to be resilient in you. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to sing The Stand. This song is just about taking a stand for Christ in the midst of our life and our circumstances. And as we sing this, let's make this your prayer that we offer our hearts completely to him. And in so, let's find the resilience that he wants to build into our lives. Let's sing together.
Now to stand. my soul now to stand. So what can I say? And what can I do?
Well, God bless you. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful week. If you want to join in on the conversation, if you're watching the YouTube premiere, depending on what device you are, the comments will be either below or on the side. And just encourage one another and bless one another. And let's remember that God wants us to be resilient in our life and our circumstances. Yeah, life is going to be difficult. And yeah, we're going to see the wind. But God is greater than the wind. And God wants us to be resilient in serving Him. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.